Good morning and welcome to Sabbath School today. We begin with prayer. Dear Father in heaven, thank you for this beautiful day you have given to us. May the healing touch of your words bring peace to our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Lesson number 3 is entitled Jesus and the Apostles' View of the Bible. The Almighty, the All-Knowing God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ could well have anticipated our modern film technology and had an angel camera crew on the scene when Jesus was crucified 2,000 years ago. Then we could have had it on our screens, absolutely accurate, portrayed on our large screen television sets, that face of Jesus, clear and undistorted by any unavoidably sinful human imitation of him. But the Father chose not to do it for us. Instead, he chose to reveal him in a book that itself throbs with life, because the same Holy Spirit who inspired it inspires our reading of it. There in the book, we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death. That would be the second death, the real thing. Crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man, Hebrews 2, verse 9. Every human heart has a built-in monitor screen whereon the Holy Spirit, as a projector, flashes a true image of Jesus. Each individual sees Jesus as the Galatians saw him, crucified among you, Galatians 3, 1. This image flashed on the conscience by the Holy Spirit is in vivid 3D, in full color, and each believing individual is summoned from the grandstands where he thinks he's only watching and becomes a participant himself in the drama, crucified with Christ, Galatians 2:20, or crucifying him afresh, Hebrews 6, verse 6. And you never in all eternity forget what you saw and knew firsthand. We could complain to the Father that he's deprived us of this actual movie that was never recorded on a film, but he would have to respond to us that his own son Jesus had no such movie setting forth the happenings from creation onto this time. Jesus had to depend instead only on the Word, the Bible. Jesus had to depend on "it is written." That had to be his experience. No angel gave Jesus any advantage greater than you and I have in what is written in the Bible. What is it and what is it not? Is it legalism? What is and what is not genuine love? How can law and love be inseparable? They appear on the surface to be incompatible. Obedience to God's law is never legalism. The perpetuity of the law is not legalism, nor is preaching the importance of obedience. Legalism is not overemphasis of the law, as though there were some secret line of balance between legalism and grace, sort of a 50-50 balance. Balance is not the issue. 99% gospel, 1% legalism, that really nullifies the gospel or frustrates it. That's to use Paul's expression of it in Galatians 2:21. The 1% of legalism will poison the whole like a small dose of arsenic ruins bread. When we define legalism as our efforts to keep the law, what do we mean? Is there a clearer Bible definition of legalism? Paul's two phrases that mean legalism are, quote, the works of the law and being, quote, under the law, unquote. This is a doing what the law requires is not legalism. The problem is that no one can do it except by the grace of Christ. The works of the law cannot justify, and as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse, writes Paul in Galatians 1:16 and 3:10. So obviously the works of the law are not true obedience to the law. They are a supposed obedience, which is deceptive. The problem is that they spring from the wrong motivation. Legalism is trying to do the right thing for the wrong reason. which T.S. Eliot aptly says is the greatest treason. In Paul's thinking, the works of the law are the opposite of faith. The negative definition discloses the positive. Note his contrast. Received ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of the law? Having begun in the Spirit, are ye now made perfect by the flesh? Galatians 3, 2 and 3. The works of the law are defined here as the work of the flesh. But there is a passage where Paul makes it even more clear. He contrasts being under the law, which is legalism, with being under grace. These are the two opposites. To be under grace is the hearing of faith and produces true obedience to the law because it delivers from the dominion of sin, Romans 6:14. The believer is under the compulsion of a new motivation imposed by a heart appreciation of the grace of God revealed in the love of Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. This new motivation transcends all hope of reward or fear of hell, which often motivates false faith. You can read about that in Desire of Ages, page 480. So Paul's definition of legalism is being under a self-centered motivation imposed either by fear of punishment or hope of reward. It is religion absorbed in a highly refined, sophisticated love of self that keeps asking itself, what is essential for my salvation? What is the least sacrifice and devotion that I can give and still squeak past the pearly gates? How close can I come to the world and still be saved? This kind of attitude is evident in the frequent question, is it really a sin to do this or that? There's a vast amount of legalism that's clogging popular Adventist thinking, and it repels sincere, thoughtful youth. We need as desperately to understand the gospel today as did the brethren back in 1888 and 1890. Gracious Father in heaven, thank you for the word of God, which Jesus lived by, it is written, and which the Apostle Paul lived in his soul and defined it clearly to us in being under grace. In Jesus' name we thank you. Amen.